WMCX is celebrating their 50th year on air. A $1.13 billion lottery ticket was sold in Neptune, and the Maiden Mammoth Crafts Fair is approaching. All this and more on this episode of Hawk TV News. Welcome back to the final episode of Hawk TV News for the semester. My name is Haley Kampschmidt.
And I'm Sage Fernandez.
Monmouth University's student-run station, WMCX, is hosting an alumni event to celebrate its 50th year on air. 88.9 has invited back all previous hosts and members in honor of its ongoing success in the communications department. WMCX is fully run by students, with its general manager being sophomore Luke Maleski. The radio station broadcasts student-produced shows as well as student-produced events, including a 24-hour live music show. The organization is not just limited to communication majors, as it is open to all Monmouth students. The 50-year celebration is taking place in the Plangier Center on May 3rd and is open to all alumni.
We are now handing things off to Brynn for a commentary on sitcom recommendations.
Hey everyone, my name is Brynn, and today I'll be sharing with you three of my favorite sitcoms of all time. If you're looking for a new, easy-to-watch show that will make you laugh, I'm here to help. So the first sitcom that I have is Schitt's Creek, and this show follows a once famous and rich family that becomes penniless overnight. And the only thing left in their name is a small and simple town, Schitt's Creek. So the characters have such a great chemistry, and the storyline is extremely entertaining and funny. I highly recommend this show if you're looking for a laugh while also following an interesting storyline. Next up, we have the show Pen 15. I just recently started watching this on Hulu and immediately loved the premise. This show is considered a cringe comedy that depicts life in middle school. So the two main characters are in their 30s but do an incredible job acting as seventh graders. Pen 15 is filled with humorously awkward moments, innocent friendships, and moments your tween self can relate to. And finally, I didn't think I'd have to mention this one, but surprisingly, I know many people who haven't watched this sitcom all the way through. So if you haven't seen The Office yet, you need to in order to become a normal member of society. And to those who don't think it's funny, you're weird. So that's all I have to say about that. But if you're looking for a new show and haven't watched Schitt's Creek, Pen 15, or The Office, I hope you give them a go. Again, my name is Brynn, and thanks for watching.
Thanks, Brynn. On March 26th, the winning ticket of the $1.13 billion Mega Millions jackpot was sold in Neptune, New Jersey. The ticket was sold at the ShopRite on Route 66. The anonymous winner surprisingly chose their own numbers rather than using the quick pick option, which automatically generates the lottery numbers. The seller of the ticket was Tiana Bambata, the niece of Neptune Township Mayor Tassie York. Bambata said that she does not know who bought the winning ticket, and lottery sales were hasty that Tuesday. This is the first New Jersey winner since July 24th, 2020, and the eighth highest jackpot ever recorded in the United States. The winner has 1 year to claim the jackpot.
With Monmouth University sitting right in the midway point between two major cities, New York City and Philadelphia, there is a big divide between New York Giants and Philadelphia Eagles fans at Monmouth. For decades, it has been territorial golden rule that the Eagles and Giants do not get along. And that has become one of the most infamous rivalries within the tri-state area in the football world. The most recent news circulating about Saquon Barkley's transfer is already creating a hostile environment with sports fans here at Monmouth University. Students' loyalties to their teams, as well as their favorite players, are creating tension with whom they should continue to support. With the upcoming 2024 and 2025 season approaching within the next few months, it will be exciting to see how Saquon's performance with the Eagles will directly impact Monmouth sports culture. Next up, here's James with a commentary.
Well, this is it. The last commentary of the 2024 semester. Man, it's shocking to say this, but I had a fun time doing these, and hopefully you enjoyed the last one that I did. Considering this is the grand finale, I couldn't think of a better way to end it than with my favorite movie of 2023, that being the Oscar-winning Godzilla Minus One. I had been a Godzilla fan for a while, and my dad introduced me to it at a very young age with a couple of VHS tapes, and I got instantly hooked on it from there. When this movie got announced in late 2022, I was excited for it because I will never say no to Godzilla, and I didn't know what to expect or how it would be, or how it performed financially. Once I saw it, however, it instantly blew me away. This film went to so many great lengths with such a small budget of only $15 million. And mind you, the director not only directed the film, but he also did the, he also was a screenwriter and the VFX artist as well. I won't spoil anything just in case you want to go see it when it eventually comes out on DVD and Blu-ray, but for basic summary, Japan is at its lowest point with nothing left and coming up the cusp of World War II. As they are trying to recuperate, they are instantly met with a new peril that emerges from the coast of Tokyo Bay in the form of Godzilla, sending them directly into a negative state. This film pays homage to the original Godzilla film back in 1954, and it captures many tones and themes such as trauma, grief, and horror. Plus, another thing that I appreciate is that usually with monster films, you just want to see the monsters and the fights and don't necessarily care about the human aspect, but for this film, they really did a nice job of telling an excellent human drama story. All of them were great, and Godzilla was terrifying and awesome. Oh yeah, and his atomic breath, which is the beam that he shoots from his mouth, is an absolute thing of beauty. In conclusion, this is one of my favorite films in the past decade, and I am happy that this got made and won a visual effects award at the Oscars this year. Please go check this film out when it releases on DVD, Blu-ray, and even streaming platforms, hopefully. It's amazing. Thank you guys for tuning in. And before I leave, there's just one more thing that I would like to announce. With this being my last commentary, this is also my last semester overall here at Monmouth University. The reason being is because I will be completing my remaining credits over the course of the summer and will earn my degree once I have completed them. And it also means I will not be returning for the fall semester. I know my time has been short since I transferred last year, but I think it's important to remember is to make the most out of the time that you spend at the school of your choosing. I would like to thank Hawk TV and the eBoard for welcoming me in with open arms, and I have made many friends from this club alone. I am forever grateful for the time I got to spend with all of you, and I wish you the best of luck wherever your futures take you. Thank you guys again, and I will send it back over to the anchors at the desk. Take care, guys.
Rocky Granada, a resident of Edison, found himself at the center of a violent altercation that shook the quiet town of Middletown. Granada, known for his New Jersey famous RV, featuring a plethora of pro-Trump imagery, including MAGA flags and a mural of the president, was allegedly assaulted with a sledgehammer by Michael Gonzalez, 36, of Philadelphia. The attack, which occurred on Friday, saw Granada sustaining multiple blows to the head with a handheld sledgehammer. Witnesses at the scene detained Gonzalez until law enforcement arrived, where he was taken into custody. Granada was swiftly airlifted to Jersey Shore University Medical Center in Neptune for urgent medical treatment, though initial reports suggested a politically motivated assault due to the presence of Granada's Trump-adorned RV outside Crown Tire. Law enforcement officials have clarified that the incident stemmed from a personal dispute rather than ideological differences. Gonzalez now faces grave charges and remains detained at the Monmouth County Jail in Freehold Township pending a detention hearing.
On Saturday, April 27th, the Monmouth County Board of County Commissions will be hosting their Made in Monmouth Crafts Fair. The event will take place from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. in TBR Robert J. Collins Arena and Recreation Events Center at Brookdale Community College. Made in Monmouth is free for visitors and will have over 200 vendors. Local vendors include a variety of art, jewelry, accessories, food, and more.
Graduation is less than a month away, and a ton of activities are lined up for Monmouth Senior Week. Starting on April 30th, the Bar Anticipation Barbecue is taking place from 9 to 11:30, where students can enjoy the all-you-can-eat barbecue. The following day, May 1st, a winery tasting and tour will be taking place at Cream Ridge Winery from 1:30 to 3:30. Next, on May 2nd, the highly anticipated Hudson River Dinner Cruise is going from 4 until 11. Students will enjoy a 2.5-hour cruise along the Hudson River aboard City Cruises, a deluxe dinner buffet, DJ, transportation, and a beautiful view of the New York City skyline will all be included in this trip. On May 3rd, the senior bingo brunch will go from 11 to 4 in the McGill Dining Commons, where students can win prizes including Monmouth memorabilia, gift cards, and other fun items. On May 4th, students can attend the Yankees and Tigers game at 1 p.m., though no transportation will be provided for this event. On the 6th, students will be bused to the newly opened Tall Oaks Farm and Brewery for a tasting and tour. This 2.5-hour trip includes 3 5-ounce samples and Jersey Mike's subs. Last, the senior sunrise will take place at the University Bluffs from 5 a.m. to 7 a.m. on May 7th. This is the final senior event where students can commemorate the end of an era and celebrate the start of something new. To all of our graduating seniors, we wish you the best of luck in this next chapter in your lives. Now here's Mairead with an update on Monmouth sports.
After 1 point loss to Hofstra in overtime, men's lacrosse dominated on both sides of the field on April 6th to beat Hampton 15-4. Monmouth had 2 quick goals in the span of 35 seconds to start the first quarter, one coming from attack number 24, Connor Gorman, and the other from midfielder number 1, Luke Cole. Hampton quickly responded with a goal of their own off of a Monmouth turnover. The Hawks went on to score the next 5 goals and ended the first period up 7-1. Hampton opened up scoring in the second quarter, but Monmouth extended their lead by scoring 3 goals before heading into break. The Pirates held the Hawks to only 3 shots on goal in the third quarter, none of which went in, while Hampton scored 2 goals of their own. The Hawks returned the favor, holding Hampton to no goals in the fourth, while scoring 5 to finalize the score 15-4. 10 different Hawks scored for Monmouth, 5 of which had more than 1 goal. Connor Gorman finished with 3 points as well as attack number 10, Brendan Dundas. Monmouth men's lacrosse is now 5-5 overall and 2-2 in CAA play. The Hawks look ahead to face Fairfield on Saturday, April 13th at Kessler Stadium. Monmouth women's lacrosse unfortunately faced their second consecutive loss on April 6th against Drexel after falling to number 15 Stony Brook on March 29th. Monmouth went into the game on March 29th coming off of a win against William & Mary but couldn't find momentum in the matchup against their third-ranked opponent this year. Monmouth got off to a quick start in the first quarter with 3 straight goals, but Stony Brook didn't allow that lead for long and scored 7 goals in just the first quarter. The Hawks scored 4 goals for the remainder of the game while Stony Brook had 11. The Hawks went on to face Drexel, who remained unbeaten in CAA play. On April 6th, the Dragons struck early with the first 3 goals of the game, and after just 15 minutes, led 5-1. In the first half, attackers number 35 Maya Brock and number 23 Caroline Brennan both scored for Monmouth on free positions. But Drexel did not allow any more goals past them and held the Hawks 11-2 going into halftime. 3 consecutive goals from Monmouth after halftime cut the deficit to 11-5. Drexel continued their momentum and scored 3 goals in the late minutes of the third quarter. Monmouth added 2 goals in the fourth quarter, but Drexel doubled, adding 4 and winning 17-7. Brock finished with 3 goals and registered her 5th hat trick of the season, while Brennan had a pair of goals that increased her total for the season to 33. Midfielder number 12, Danielle McNeely, had a pair of goals herself, securing her 8th multi-goal game this year. Monmouth goalkeeper Katie Sullivan had her 8th double-digit save performance of the season with 13 saves on the day. Women's lacrosse will take on Hofstra on Friday, April 12th.
Thanks, Mairead. That's all for this episode. Thank you for watching our final episode of News for the Semester. My name is Sage Fernandez.
And I'm Haley Cam Schmidt. We are now going to send things over to producers Brynn and Andrew for a special message.
Hey everyone, my name is Brynn and I'm the executive producer of Hawk TV News.
And I'm Andrew and I'm also producer of News.
So this is our final shoot as producers and we want to thank everyone who shows up to the shoots and contributes. We couldn't run the show without you guys.
We're so excited to see what great things future members do for News, as well as the new producers, Sage and Ava.
Thank you for a great year and an incredible experience, and good luck next year.